So tree inventory, let's talk about that first. And again, this is just some deck slide decks. And again, it's the same data, it's just in a different format, right? So basically for each tree, we auto number the tree, that's the first field, and then we have an alt tree ID, which can be the same number, but it's usually a different number that they've assigned to the tree. How many people have uniquely identified every tree, or mostly trees? Yeah. So a lot of times you do that if you have, how many people here are using a contractor to do tree trimming through the city? Yeah, so they'll have a unique ID, and then their status, tree code. We have a tree library that we have in our system, so you can pick a tree code, and then it'll automatically bring the common name, the genus, the species, the cultivar, down based on that library of trees, right? So that library trees, and we'll go over that. I think I have some slides. I haven't really looked at this. It's been, now it seems like ages ago, because I've been doing a presentation every hour almost, so I don't remember exactly what was in every slide. I didn't have time to look at it, but this is the status. So these are the statuses that he had. He used inactive and active, a tree failure, in stock, establishment, and the PG&E facility removal. So the one that was interesting to me was in stock. So he brought a bunch of trees, and they were, instead of using a warehouse for his trees, he had, these were trees that were ready to be planted that he had bought and they'd set aside. So he got the trees so he would know basically what the tree was, what type of tree it was, because it had the tree code, and he knew it was in their warehouse. So what he did is they had a group, an organization that liked to go around and plant all these trees. So the city, and I'll go over this, but he knew that if he did a filter on in stock, he could pick the trees that he wanted them to plant at certain places, because he knew what he had in stock ready for those people to plant. And then he'd create a work order and then assign those work orders for those people to plant them. And then he would attach those trees, and he'd have a location for every tree where it was going to go. So it was kind of unique. I don't know. Maybe it's not unique, but I thought it was interesting. Tree types, another field where it was a street tree, a park tree, a greenbelt tree, streetscape tree, median tree, nursery tree, those kinds of things. That was kind of his list, right? Yeah, you bet. Yes? Exactly. Well, yes. You could put in the correct address at the time. You could also change the status to now active. It's now actively at that location. It didn't create a new tree record or anything like that. Yes, that's correct. Sorry. And then he had certain trees that were special trees, right? These are special designations of trees. It was a landmark tree. It was a memorial tree. I don't know what a GHG, UFP tree is. I've forgotten what that was. But anyway, these are special trees. You can see here that there's a tab for tree commission. And that was something that we created for him, because he had a tree commission that met twice a month, I think, something like that, where if you were going to do any work on a landmark tree or a memorial tree or I forget exactly what trees that they worked on, it had to go in front of the tree commission first, and then they had a vote on it whether or not they were allowed to do it or not. So this was a tab, and we'll go over that, a tab that tracked all that. This is planted. Who planted the tree? Did the city plant the tree? Did the Davis plant it? Volunteer group? So he's tracking who planted the tree. You know, obviously they track the dates, that kind of thing. So that was the first tab. Let me go back here. I don't know if there's a lot of other fields in this first tab. Just to kind of show that, obviously we have an address for the tree. We have a grid location. If you use a grid location, a lot of people were using the, 1 through 10 or 1 through 9 in the lots, as far as where did they plant the tree in that lot, whether it's from the side street or not. Then you can link it to a park. It was just a relationship, so you could pop in a park. You could pop in a parking lot. You could park in a circuit number if it was a part of an electric system, and if that tree fell, it might hit that electrical circuit, because we have electrical modules too. Street segment, what street segment was it on? What sidewalk, what would it might have been up there? And then stormwater conduit, storm structure, detention basin, if it's in the detention basin. So various ways you can link a tree to various other items. That makes sense? So just, again, how much time you want to spend doing that. They have a date planted, obviously. That's a pretty important thing. If there was a previous tree at that same location, they could go ahead and put that previous tree there because maybe something was wrong with the soil type or something. They could look that up and say, this tree had these problems. It might have been because of the previous tree or whatever, and they knew that. Same thing with the removal date, what date it was removed. And when they planted it, what was the diameter and what was the cost? Well, what happens is if you have a previous tree here, it just kind of builds. So you put in another tree, a new tree, you'd create a new record. Then I would put this tree ID in that previous tree field as the previous tree field in that same spot. You could just go backwards. And these are just attributes. He didn't get to the level. I don't know if you'd ever get to the level of tracking all this information either. This is more of a current thing. What's the current trunk diameter, the canopy spread, the height, the shape, the crown spread, the overhead wire presence, all this stuff. And actually, that's really part of an inspection. And I'm not exactly sure how the web works, but in the desktop, there were certain fields that if these were fields also in the inspection form. And so when you save the inspection, it updated this to the most recent, kind of like an inspection does with condition ratings and stuff. Here's the date it was, and here's what the new conditions were. So it always update the most recent diameter, the most recent height, the most recent spread. And some of these, you know, are just drop downs. Oops. I think I'm running the program. Sorry. So I don't know. It's on special watch. I'm not sure exactly what all these things mean, but they're just fields and they can be renamed. These are landscape areas, landscaping and landscape areas, ALA, what length, width, diameter, area. So if it's got one of those. Any questions about anything you're seeing on that screen? Can you see it okay from where you are? Okay, all right. All right. Ready for the next slide? Okay. And this was the tree commission, right? So here was the motion that, and the reason he did this is because he used to do it all by hand, and he would have to take all this notes on by hand, and then he'd have to go and type it all up at the end. Once we put this in the system for him, he was able to have the laptop just, and he would just type it in as they were doing these motions and who made the motion and who seconded it and who passed it. And so then he could just run a report at the end and he was done. So it just helped speed his time up immensely. So he would just find the tree, put the motion in, and whether they waived the fee or not. So does this all make sense? Did anybody commission rating? Okay, so that's the reason they had that. Of course, right? I don't know that. But where could you track that in Lucidy? Is that what you want to know? Is how do I track it into what tree I track it to? So you could do that with your custom fields. So hold it. Let me ask you this. You wouldn't know at the time when they put the funds there that it goes to a certain tree, right? Because it could go to any tree, maybe, those funds. No, that's fine. We got plenty of time to discuss, I think. There's not that much in trees, so let's dig into some stuff. Yes. Whoa. Okay. Hey, that's what financial integrations are. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah. It's not off the chain, but yeah, I understand what you're saying exactly. But you're still responsible for spending the money that they're giving you the right way. Yeah, right. Oh, I understand. Show me how you spent my money, because I'm giving you this money to do that. Sure. Not in the things that he did, but because this is old. This is version probably 13, 15, you know, it's old stuff. So I'm assuming in trees, because every asset has account number, project number. So if you had an account or a project number, you would know which ones. But again, the spending of that money, is that going to be a work order where you're tracking and then taking that from there? So really, we're not set up really to be a financial system to track. Here's money's coming, and here's certainly money going away. We can track as work orders happen. But yeah, it's a really interesting problem you got. Okay. I never heard that, and he never asked me to put anything, but I would really sense it would be hard for us to put it in there just for that reason. You bet. We skipped plantings, but shoot, we really skipped a lot of things. And I'll go over this maybe with when I go over to the web, but plantings is basically just if there's plantings around the tree, so you have a tree here and you have a bunch of flowers or tulips around it or whatever, that's kind of what that's for. And then inspections, obviously, to inspect the tree, we're going to go over that. Risk assessments, which is the next tab, we're going to go over that. And then obviously the work orders and requests and stuff, you can attach a work order to every tree that you do things to. Yes. Yeah, that's part of your inspection. That's your general condition, and we'll go over that. And then, of course, they have custom. Okay, the request and work orders. Okay, this was just kind of to show you, since I was on work orders, kind of the data that they track while they're doing their trees. So, again, this is a mistletoe removal on this tree. That's your task, and they had a comment from the customer, you know, and stuff. So they're tracking things that they're doing, cause, what was the cause of the problem, who's assigned to it. So in this case, the West Coast Arborist, who's a big tree maintenance group in the West Coast, who assigned it, etc. Just thought I'd show you a few things here. This is their problems. I went ahead and clicked on their problem button because I was just on the phone with them and I did a bunch of screen captures. So it took more than could be shown really here, but this a lot of stuff. Anybody having questions about the problems? I mean, you associate problems with trees and stuff. So I thought it might be, and I can make this PowerPoint available to you if you're interested in having it, if you're ever wanting to see this stuff. He doesn't have a problem with that. This is their task that they had in their list, at least the ones that I could fit on the slide. There's still more at the bottom. But again, just tasks that they have associated. They went to some pretty interesting detail about some stuff, but I'm not a maintenance guy of a tree, so I don't really know what I'm seeing. But and then these are causes that they had. I don't know if you can read it from where you are anyway, but causes of things, problems. So basically your standard stuff. And this gives you an example of what I said when they had a group, a voluntary group that was going to go ahead and plant the trees. He would go ahead and set up this tree in this work orders, and he would have for, you can see that the task says plant new tree, and this was the type of tree that they were supposed to plant at this address, and then they had a total cost of how much it was going to cost to do that. So this is the volunteers that are doing that, so they could pretty quickly, he could organize it all, give it to the group, and let them plant those trees. They grabbed those trees from their warehouse or their where they stored all their trees, and away they went. Okay, any questions about that? Okay, pretty straightforward. So we'll go a little bit into their tree inspections, and to be real honest, he did more of these inspections than the assessments, but he tried out the assessment one. Again, when he did it, this is the tree inventory information. So this is stuff that you could update when you're doing your inspection. And then when you save the inspection, they could update the inventory record because the tree diameter might have grown, the spread might have been bigger, the clearance might have been unacceptable at one point or something like that. You know, so it's going to update the inventory record. Okay, so the activity was in either inspection. He did tree trimming with the activity code instead of doing it with a work order sometimes and a tree risk assessment. This was his clearance, and this is just kind of the data that he stored for clearances is one of the fields. Because, again, with Lucidy, when you get Lucidy, it's blank, right? There's some fields filled out sometimes, but you can have to change your own, make your own fields. This is the next tab, which is general condition tab. So this is your tree condition, your trunk condition, your structural condition, the pest presence, disease present, maintenance needs, and mulch condition, soil condition, moisture condition, weed condition, and pruning condition. So just kind of what the conditions are of the trees. And you can use as much or as little of this as you want to. Obviously, when it's saved back to the tree after they do it, I think it takes the tree condition and says this is the most recent tree condition and the next inspection date and the inspected date. I don't know if it has any other ones in there. Can't remember. So this is how you this is what you would use if you wanted to determine the value of the tree, right? Trees are the only asset in your agency that will keep increasing in value over time. So based on the trunk size and based on the health of it, it'll calculate, and it uses a standard formula that he gave me, and it was a long time ago, so I don't remember the name of it, but from an arborist group, they had a way to determine the value of a tree with a couple different methods. There was a trunk formula method, and there was a replacement cost valuation method. Do either one of those ring any bells to anybody? No? Yes? Okay, so did anybody care about this? I could kind of walk you through it if you probably want to, but you don't really need to if you're, it's pretty deep into some stuff. But just to let you know, based on what the conditions are, it comes up with a rating value, and then you have a species factor that's part of the library of the species, and then what kind of condition it's in, and installed cost, location factors, and then it will calculate for you a replacement value here or a trunk form here based on a condition. So you can establish a rating, and it's a standard process that they use. It was a standard back, you know, they're Californian, so I don't know. But it looked like it was a standard from the National Arborist Association or something like that. Yeah, right. Probably what? Yeah, that sounds right. Yeah. So International Association of Arborists or something, or National Society of Arborists, maybe? Okay, arboriculture. Okay, there we go. And then treatments, if you did any treatments while you were there doing your inspections, what type of treatment was done. Again, it's just a lot of data, so you can use it or not use it. And you can always rename any of these fields if you wanted to track something else. And we have custom and comments. So that's one type. That's their general inspection. And then there's an assessment. So inspection kind of tells you what the condition it is, potentially what the value is. The assessment is, what would happen if that tree fell down? Or what would happen if the branch of that tree fell down? What would it hurt? What could it hurt? And again, this is another standard process that, and I'm not sure exactly where this came, but I don't even think it was him. It was somebody else that sent me this. But he understood it, and he looked at it, and he ran through it, and he thought, yeah, this is going to be good. But it's a very, very time-consuming process to track all this stuff. And so, yes. Well, if the tree was over a sidewalk and that branch, no. Let's take a look. I don't think so. I don't remember exactly. So we have a tree, we have an inspection date, and then who assigned it, all that stuff, what the tree really is. And then we have, here's the targets. So these targets are what could be hit by that tree. Right? Is it the house? Is it a fence? Is it a parked car? Whatever might happen, what might be able to be hit. So each one of those targets gets a number, right? And is it practical to move it, et cetera, that kind of thing. So here's your assessment, your target description, target zone, those kinds of things. And then you have your site. This is the location where the tree's sitting on. So you have, is it a history of failures or what type of site changes could be made, what kind of soil conditions are there, weather aspects there are, the history of failures, describe the site changes and the soil changes, and then what type of, how vigorous is the tree, and what kind of foliage does it have, and the species failure profile, and if there are any pests visible. So again, all I did was I took his form that they had to fill out, and I put it into a computer system, right? So does this all make sense? What you're tracking, kind of? You're just assessing the tree, basically. You're assessing the tree because you're trying to determine what's the probability of that tree really having a problem. What, you know, that kind of thing. Crown branches, again, just a whole bunch of stuff on crowns and branches and missing bark, and well, these are crowns at the top, kind of in. I don't know where my mouse went, so I'm going to use this mouse. Oh, my mouse even moving? Okay, here it is. This part up here is the is the crown, and this part over here are branches. That's why I put a B in front of them. And just, again, just putting a bunch of information here about the branches. And then we have the trunk and a whole bunch of stuff about the trunk. And this is all about the trunk and this whole thing about trying to figure out what kind of condition the trunk's in and what kind of condition the roots are in. And now we get to risks. Okay, so this branch here is extending, overextended branch. It has a probability of failure of X. It's unlikely in this case, or maybe it'd be likely or whatever. And the same thing with the whole tree. Here's a condition of concern. The whole tree could fail. And if the whole tree fails, what would happen depending upon which way it fell? Here's the fall distance. Here's the part size. Here's the target number that it could hit based on that first page of what the targets were. And then you could say, once you've got all that listed, you go to the mitigation and what could you possibly do to help prevent that from happening, right? And then you have to figure out, okay, what's the risk rating of that combination? Okay. And then here's your mitigation options. You can mitigate this, you can mitigate that, and the priority and residual risk. And that's it. And so then you have an overall tree risk rating, overall residual rating type of thing. Sounds like fun? So, you know, who knew all? I had no idea they did all this with trees. I think it's pretty cool. I didn't know when I started developing a form that probably nobody would ever use it because it's pretty complicated. But it's there if you want to use it. So that was kind of it. That's trees, right? We have tree inventory, we have tree inspections, and we have tree assessments. That's what we have with trees. Now, the other thing you do is you do a lot of work on trees. You do a lot of work on trees by contract. You got to do a lot of work on trees by yourself, right? So let's talk about contracted work. City of Fontana, I work pretty closely with them. They have a lot of trees. They've put all their trees, but they use West Coast Arborists, again, to do all their trees. And so I thought I'd talk about how they automatically bring all their data that they do for their work and push it into the system and what they're using it for and how they tied that to GIS. So again, they did a presentation a couple years ago, and so I just grabbed a bunch of their screen slides because I happen to have it on my system still. I thought I'd go over that with you guys. So this is their tree trimming services using GIS to monitor productivity. So I don't remember if how much of this. So the service is performed by a contractor, and they also have in-house crews that do tree trimming to a minor extent. What they do is they assign the contractor an area, and I think they split up their whole entire city by 7 zones, something like that. And so in 7 years, they're supposed to do a whole route through an entire city, right? So they have, and they kind of had to balance what trees were in zone 1, zone 2, zone 3, zone 4, right? So whatever. The contractor then provides them. Then they provide the contractor. Well, the contractor gave them initially the inventory of all their trees. The contractor, West Coast Arborist, was hired to do a total tree inventory. So they had that, and then we just uploaded that into Lucidy. And, of course, we used the West Coast Arborist's unique ID codes, so they're in our system. And then once a week, the contractor provides them an export, or maybe it's once a month, but I think it's more often than that. They provide them an exported Excel file, which they can then use the import and update program to load up all the trees, right? And as part of that upload process, they know that they contracted for $50 a tree every time it gets trimmed, right? So they know that as each tree gets trimmed, they can count automatically how much was the cost of that task for that day or that week or whatever. Make sense? Oh, I'm sorry. They upload it monthly. I hadn't read that, so. It's been a while since I looked at these slides. And time-consuming validation process. What was time-consuming wasn't, we pushed the data in, but what they were having a struggle with initially was, well, how do we know they're doing the right trees? They're doing trees, but it might not be the right location, right? So that's why they eventually went into and tied it to their spaces. So In their case, they had 71,000 trees. This is a few years ago. This is kind of how their city's shaped. And they did these same, you know, tree inventory records. And they have, you can see that this, they have a trim cycle. They're using the custom fields. And you might not be able to see that very well, but this field here is trim cycle, and they called it a five-year trim cycle. And they had, this is a tree trim area one. So they had some trees that were on a faster cycle than every 5 years, but most of their trees were on a five-year cycle, right? And is there anything else that was important here? Not that I remember. Okay. So this is what they're basically with their system with all the trees installed, and you can kind of see in the colored areas what their tree areas were, where their five zones were. And then they had these special districts. Does anybody here have special districts they had to worry about? They have, oh shoot, something like 200 to 300 special districts. And so they had to know exactly how much they spent in each special district so they could charge that special district for it. So they merged the special districts as a layer, and every tree knew what special district it was part of. So then they could say, how much work did we do in this special district? And so they could charge that district appropriately or something like that. Keep track of how much cost they used in that district. That makes sense for everybody? So that was a big thing, and that's actually the same thing for everything the city does. Is every maintenance task that they do within those special districts has to be tracked against that special district. And that took a bit to get that going. So this is kind of a five-year prune cycle. This kind of shows the trees, trim schedules, and stuff. The next one will then show. I don't remember exactly, but that's just an example of, I guess, a GIS map and how they presented it in terms of the various things. So each one of these was the park that it was in, the number they trimmed in the park, and the number scheduled to be scheduled in that area, I guess is what that was. That's what these, if you can't read that, that's what these guys are here. Okay. Once there was a single user Excel spreadsheet available to staff and a map, now this information is available in the field because they were able to take it out in the tablets and management. And they did a lot of these things with, okay. So this is another thing they did, which was the planning module. Anybody go to the budget and the planning and budgeting module session? Okay, so what they used here was, this allows them to say, I want to do this many, in this case they know it was 71,000 pipe trees. They want to do it once every 5 years, so that would be however many trees that is, 58,000 or whatever, 5,800 or some odd trees per year or whatever it is, whatever the number is. Then they're going to say how many do we actually get done that month? Is a contractor on schedule, basically? Because they kind of know how much they should be getting done every month. And so then they can go ahead and use this to say, is the contractor on task or are they falling behind task from their job? Right? And you can do that with your own crews as well. Same type of thing. Then what they did is they had this, again, the same kind of annual totals for these trees. And they got this kind of grouping. And they color-coded them based on where they were. But what they found when they started doing it is, like, this is a 2015, July to December 2015 cycle. Well, they were supposed to be in number five, I think this is the fifth year cycle, or somewhere. But anyway, they were finding that they were jumping all over the place, and they were not in necessarily the areas or the zones they planned on being, because they were able to color code things on the GIS map. And they could say, well, why the heck are you doing a tree way out here? You know, what's causing that? We didn't schedule that. Or why'd you do these trees down here? You should have been in this area. You might have done the same number of trees, but they weren't the right trees. Right? And I think what this is this was like a spreadsheet showing the data that was then populated into Lucidy, that got uploaded into Lucidy using that import and update program, with the cost of each tree that was done, and this was the service request pruning. So we actually created a work order that said service request pruning, in the asset list, it would list all these trees, and the total cost for that task. It would list total up all the costs for each individual tree and put in the task cost. Okay. And this problem, we use this problem a lot because we could then filter on that problem for which ones WCA did. That was their task code. Because they did other tasks too. So sometimes we use other tasks. So. And again, they had codes for wrong trim cycle, outside trim, vendor trim area and stuff. So they're using GIS quite a bit just to keep track of it all. Immersion. And I can't do the presentation justice, but I thought it'd be helpful to see this stuff for you guys. And this is another way to see the data, I guess. This is overall percent complete, a zone percent complete, zone total, so you could count track how many was in each zone, zone latest month, zone fund completion, zone fund park completion. It was actually a GIS dashboard that they created. They have a guy who's an expert at GIS, and so they love to get in here and do GIS stuff and using the Lucid data, it's open and stuff, and being able to do pretty fantastic stuff. So I wish he could make it this year. But he oftentimes does presentations too. Well, that's my 2-hour deep dive into trees. I can show you now in the web. So if you want to see it in the web, we can talk about what your issues are too and what kind of questions you might have. So I will blow this away unless somebody needs to see one of the slides again.